Good evening, everybody. On behalf of the Forum of Cardiac Anesthesiologists Bangalore, which is renamed as Bangalore Chapter of IACTA now, I welcome you to this Cardiac Anesthesia Critical Care Update. And today we will be discussing about myasthenia gravis. Hari Krishna will be presenting it. I request all of you to keep the mics muted and video shut till the end of the talk. Only Hari Krishna's mic will be on and video will be on. And please help us to have a good quality webinar by having the microphones muted. With this, I request Hari Krishna to present his topic of myasthenia gravis. Dr. Hari Krishna, please carry on.
Thank you, sir. Sharing screen, sir. Am I visible, sir?
Yes, your slides are visible.
Okay, sir. Good evening, everyone. My topic of presentation is myasthenia gravis and thymoma surgery, a clinical update for the cardiothoracic anesthesiologist. Introduction, myasthenia gravis is the most common disorder of neuromuscular transmission. Its prevalence is approximately 150 to 250 cases per 1 million cases. There is a female predominance in patients with early age, second to third decades of onset of the disease, and a male preponderance in those with the late onset, usually 6 to 7 decades of symptoms. Myasthenia gravis is characterized by generalized or localized weakness of skeletal muscles. It is an autoimmune disease that results from autoantibodies against acetylcholine receptors in mostly 75% of the cases, or functionally related molecules like muscle-specific kinase and lipoprotein receptor-related protein 4, LRP4, involved in neuromuscular transmission. These autoantibodies trigger the degradation of their targets via complement-mediated damage and inflammation. Patients with myasthenia gravis have an increased risk of mortality in comparison to matched controls. Therefore, aggressive diagnosis is indicated to identify patients who can achieve long-term benefits, stable remission, with definite surgical therapy, that is thymectomy. This is a figure showing what myasthenia gravis actually does. You can see that the pathology is in the neuromuscular junction. In neuromuscular junction, there are acetylcholine binding sites for the neuromuscular transmission, through which sodium channels open up and sodium goes in. Now, the antibodies are directed against these acetylcholine receptors, which binds and prevents the activation of these channels. Pathophysiology. Normally, a chemical impulse precipitates the release of acetylcholine from vesicles on the nerve terminal at the myoneural junction. The acetylcholine continuously binds to the receptor site on the motor end plate for muscle contraction to sustain. In figure A, we can see that there is a normal acetylcholine receptor site. Vesicles in the terminal of the axon, there are acetylcholine vesicles which are released and which binds to the acetylcholine receptor to propagate the neuromuscular transmission. And in figure B, we can see that antibodies are developed against these receptors, as a result of which neuromuscular transmission is getting impaired. Now, this is an age-old test known as the Edrifonium test, also known as the Tensilone test or the Epsilon test in different parts. It's an basically, it is an acetylcholine esterase inhibitor. And what we try to do is we inhibit the acetylcholine esterase, preventing the degradation of acetylcholine. So it combines with the antibodies and improves the symptoms. The onset of action is approximately 30 to 60 seconds, and duration of action usually lasts for 5 to 10 minutes. Side effects include bradycardia, asystole, and bronchoconstriction. It requires cardiac monitoring and resuscitation facilities during the test. Atropine 0.5 to 2 mg should be available if severe cholinergic reaction occurs, like sweating, increased weakness and respiratory secretion, laryngospasm, bradycardia, hypotension, nausea, and vomiting. A test dose of 1 mg, 0.1 ml of Tensilone should be given. After 1 minute, a further 4 mg, 0.4 ml is given. And if no change in the examination is noted in 1 minute, the remainder of the vial, 5 mg or 0.5 ml, can be given. The same depicting the edrifonium, inhibiting acetylcholine esterase, preventing the degradation of acetylcholine, which competes with the antibodies and improves the neuromuscular transmission. The classification system is known as the Osserman's classification. In class 1, there is any ocular muscle weakness. In class 2, there is mild weakness other than ocular. It can be subdivided into 2A and 2B. In 2A, there is predominantly limb, axial, or both. and 2B predominantly oropharyngeal and or respiratory. In class 3, there is moderate weakness other than ocular. 3A is predominantly limb, axial or both. And 3B, again, predominantly oropharyngeal or respiratory. Class 4 is severe weakness other than ocular. 4A is predominantly limb, axial or both. And 4B is predominantly oropharyngeal or respiratory. And class 5 is intubation with or without ventilation. Now, treatment options for myasthenia gravis or the treatment in which the patients are usually on. They could be on long-acting anticholinesterases like pyridostigmine bromide, neostigmine bromide. Immunosuppressive therapies like systemic steroids, azathioprine, cyclosporine, methotrexate, cyclophosphamide, surgical thymectomy, plasmapheresis, and intravenous immunoglobulin. Now, it's a simple flowchart showing what usually happens to the patients when they are once they are diagnosed with myasthenia gravis. Once usually the symptoms and signs compatible ocular myasthenia gravis happen, so you have to search for a retrosternal mass in the chest CT or MRI. And if you can actually find out a mass, you can do thymectomy only if its diagnosis is definite. And you can start the patient on cholinesterase inhibitors. And if the response is satisfactory, you can continue like that. If no response is not satisfactory, you step up into corticosteroids. And you have to see whether the response is satisfactory. Again, continue if it is same. Or if it long-term corticosteroid treatment with more than 20 milligram per day of prednisolone or equivalent is required. Or if the response is not satisfactory, you can shift to azathioprine also. After 6 months add-on therapy with azathioprine, approximately 2 to 2.5 milligram per kilogram per day, taper to a minimum dose of corticosteroids. And subsequently, you can wean off like that. Now, preoperative assessment. The preoperative preparation of patients with myasthenia gravis undergoing thymectomy should be focused on optimizing the neuromuscular transmission to avoid both myasthenic and cholinergic crisis. Perioperative factors associated with myasthenia gravis exacerbation to be considered include type of surgery, trauma, infection, fatigue, thyroid disease, preoperative bulbar symptoms, medications affecting neuromuscular junction, and opioids. The quantity of preoperative circulating acetylcholine receptor antibodies usually does not reliably predict an individual's response to myasthenia gravis treatment or the risk of postoperative myasthenia crisis. Preoperative preparation as well as strategies to optimize patients scheduled for thymectomy should include the adjustment of pyridostigmine dose, improving neuromuscular transmission while avoiding cholinergic crisis, along with the optimization of their immunotherapy regimen. Glucocorticoids can be considered first-line drugs for immunosuppression. Objective clinical improvement is observed only after 4 to 8 weeks of treatment, and transient worsening of symptoms can be observed after their initiation. Patients with unstable clinical symptoms prior to surgery or emergency procedures can be candidates for bridge therapy with intravenous immunoglobulin or plasmapheresis. The latter will lead to remission of myasthenia gravis symptoms in 45% of the cases. However, the symptomatic improvement may require up to 8 exchanges, and the results are temporary, usually last for 1 to 2 weeks. In a study by Sang et al., evaluating the impact of plasmapheresis prior to thymectomy, the authors concluded that elective thymectomy without preoperative plasmapheresis in myasthenia gravis patients did not affect the overall outcomes when compared with preoperative apheresis. Plasmapheresis is associated with hypotension, coagulopathy, and also comes with a high cost. Now, further investigations include a routine 12-lead electrocardiogram should be included in the cardiac evaluation since myasthenia gravis patients can present with electrical conduction disorders. Patients with thymoma can present with signs suggestive of myocarditis or congestive heart failure, for which echocardiography might be needed to evaluate the heart contractility. The cardiopulmonary function can be tested using the 6-minute walk distance. Hayashi et al. Reported that a low preoperative 6-minute walk distance, approximately less than 500 meters, was associated with delayed postoperative ambulation and longer hospital stay. The need for postoperative ventilation should be addressed and discussed with patients before surgery. A computed tomography, CT, in particular a multi-detector CT, should be obtained to delineate the anatomical airway and relations of the tumors with vascular structures, including the aorta, pulmonary artery, or superior vena cava. Pulmonary function tests are characterized by a low vital capacity, normal total lung capacity, and normal or elevated residual volume. When airway compression is present, the severity of the symptoms in combination with the radiological images can dictate the method of induction of general anesthesia, intravenous followed by muscle relaxation versus inhalational with spontaneous ventilation. The latter method is typically recommended in patients with severe distress in sitting position. Approximately 10 to 15% of the patients with myasthenia gravis have other autoimmune disorders. Hypothyroidism from autoimmune thyroiditis can worsen the symptoms of myasthenia gravis Therefore, thyroid function should be investigated in patients who do not respond to conventional therapies. Myasthenia gravis patients can present with concomitant systemic lupus erythematosus and rheumatoid arthritis that should be thoroughly evaluated to detect cervical spine instability. Other comorbidities associated with myasthenia gravis include obstructive sleep apnea, polymyositis, neuromyotonia, hypogammaglobulinemia, and blood cytopenias. Osteoporosis, hyperglycemia, and hypertension should be investigated in patients taking chronic steroids. Further, intraoperative management. Now, the surgical approach. Minimal invasive video or robotically assisted surgical techniques have been shown to be an equally effective alternative to open transsternal thymectomy and therefore should be considered for myasthenia gravis patients. Minimal invasive surgeries have been associated with improved outcomes as it relates to pain, blood loss, complications, myasthenic crisis, and hospital length of stay. One important concern related to robotic MIS is the potential for positioning related injuries, in particular when the axillary approach is used to access the mediastinum. General considerations. The intraoperative management of patients undergoing thymectomy for myasthenia gravis follows the same consideration of that for open thoracotomies or video-assisted thoracoscopy. Maintenance of normothermia is indicated. However, several studies suggest that mild hypothermia may improve myasthenia gravis symptoms. Conversely, overheating can trigger muscle weakness. Continuous hemodynamic monitoring with an intra-arterial catheter is advised. Adequate intravenous access with two large bore peripheral venous catheters is recommended. Lower extremity access can be considered in patients with large thymic masses with potential for SVC syndrome. Fluoroquinolones, that is ciprofloxacin, moxifloxacin or levofloxacin, macrolides, erythromycin, and aminoglycosides like gentamicin should be avoided because they can induce muscle weakness during or after surgery by impairing neuromuscular transmission. Most thymectomies, open transsternal or video-assisted thoracoscopic extended thymectomy, are performed under general anesthesia and mechanical one-lung ventilation for which a double lumen tube or a bronchial blocker placement is used. Now, moving on to sedatives and general anesthetics. Sedatives and volatile anesthetics can exacerbate myasthenia gravis. Total intravenous anesthesia with propofol infusion or balanced general anesthesia with a low dose of volatile anesthetic in combination with epidural analgesia may be the technique of choice. If regional anesthesia is contraindicated, the combination of propofol and remifentanil is also a safe technique to maintain general anesthesia. The combination of propofol and remifentanil with endotracheal intubation or laryngeal mask airway has also been used during open transsternal thymectomy as a means to avoid neuromuscular blockage. Avoidance of neuromuscular blockers may not be successful without relatively high rates of remifentanil infusion. The duration of action of oral pyridostigmine is 3 to 4 hours with patients on dosing schedules that vary from every 3 to 6 hours. Therefore, some patients undergoing prolonged procedures may require intraoperative redosing to maintain adequate levels of drug in the plasma. To guide the dosing of intravenous pyridostigmine, it is worth remembering that 1 mg of intravenous pyridostigmine is equivalent to 30 mg orally. Now, regional anesthesia and analgesia. Epidural analgesia has been successfully used to provide analgesia to patients undergoing thymectomy. The technique reduces the consumption of intravenous opioids and general anesthetics, is associated with better pulmonary function in postoperative period, and can accelerate the recovery of patients. Other regional anesthesia techniques such as paravertebral, serratus anterior, intercostal nerve, and erector spinae blocks can be used. However, there is limited evidence regarding their efficacy in the context of myasthenia gravis surgery. There are no current studies investigating the role of enhanced recovery after surgery, ERAS protocol, specifically for patients with myasthenia gravis. Muscle relaxants. The use of neuromuscular blocking agents on patients with myasthenia gravis has long been associated with complications of residual neuromuscular blocking. The efficacy of depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agents, succinylcholine, is unreliable secondary to the conflicting effects from presence of acetylcholine receptor antibodies and the associated destruction of acetylcholine receptors. In addition, the routine use of anticholinesterase medications render depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agents less effective for relaxation and also prolong the duration of action. Some have chosen to not administer anticholinesterase medications on the day of surgery in order to improve the efficacy of neuromuscular blockers. However, this practice is in conflict. If non-depolarizing neuromuscular blocking agents are used, the amount given should be reduced to one-third or less, depending on the severity of the myasthenia gravis disease. With the use of objective quantitative neuromuscular monitors, the amount of neuromuscular blocking agents to facilitate intubation can be titrated to the individual patient. Subsequent redosing can be a fraction of the intubation dose and triggered by the return of train of four response or diaphragmatic excursion. The conventional anticholinesterase medication, neostigmin, may not reliably reverse neuromuscular blocking agents, and if used in excess, may precipitate cholinergic crisis. It is important to consider that neostigmin has an effective duration of approximately an hour. Therefore, patients who receive neostigmin should be closely monitored postoperatively for signs of recurrentization and receive longer-acting anticholinesterase as appropriate. In an effort to avoid unreliability and potential complications of neostigmin, the patient can remain intubated postoperatively until complete muscle strength has returned, with non-invasive ventilation used as a potential bridge following extubation. Sugammadex in patients with myasthenia gravis. Sugammadex is a cyclodextrin derivative which irreversibly encapsulates steroidal neuromuscular blocking agents, that is rocuronium, removing them from the nicotinic receptor. The efficacy of Sugammadex to reverse rocuronium-induced muscle relaxation is superior to neostigmin. Though there is a lack of strong evidence to recommend the routine use of Sugammadex in patients with myasthenia gravis, several case series have documented the successful use of this drug with no postoperative respiratory failure, myasthenic or cholinergic crisis. The use of Sugammadex in no way obviates the need for neuromuscular monitoring, as a failure to objectively monitor would increase the risk of excessively deep neuromuscular blockade, resulting in an inadequate dosing of Sugammadex. In patients with myasthenia gravis who has not returned to the baseline TOF ratio following an additional dose of Sugammadex, one should consider the possibility of an acute worsening of myasthenia gravis by surgery or other factors and treat with anticholinesterases. Even with optimal care, patients with severe myasthenic disease may need to remain intubated following surgery until they meet clinical criteria for safe extubation. Postoperative anesthetic management for patients with myasthenia gravis. In terms of muscle strength, it is not expected to observe significant clinical improvement immediately after surgery. Therefore, planning for postoperative care includes the possibility of postoperative ventilation and intensive care admission, the reinitiation of postoperative anticholinesterase medications, and continuation of chronic immunotherapy treatment. Patients with myasthenia gravis have higher risk of postoperative pneumonia, septicemia, postoperative bleeding, and overall complications. Postoperative monitoring and patient's disposition should be determined by the anesthesiologist at the conclusion of the case based on vital signs at the end of the surgical procedure, attainment of extubation criteria, the surgical procedure which is performed, the type of anesthetic which is administered, the intraoperative course, and the pain assessment. Postoperative respiratory insufficiency should be considered and investigated, since it can lead to reintubation and prolonged mechanical ventilation. Myasthenic crisis, cholinergic crisis, recurrentization, and phrenic nerve paralysis can cause respiratory insufficiency after a thymectomy. Several authors have identified predictors of postoperative ventilation in myasthenic patients undergoing thymectomy. The study suggests that severity of the myasthenic gravis, history of preoperative myasthenic crisis, acetylcholine, anti-acetylcholine antibodies positive, presence of thymoma, and a vital capacity less than 2.9 liters are independent risk factors for postoperative mechanical ventilation. Moving on to postoperative analgesia. Adequate analgesia is an important component of the postoperative care of myasthenia gravis patients. Given the inherent disease, process patients already are predisposed to difficulty with breathing and coughing. Pain only serves to increase this difficulty and potentially can lead to respiratory insufficiency. On the other hand, overtreatment of pain with excessive analgesics can potentially lead to respiratory depression or a myasthenic crisis. Pain management with regional techniques, that is neuraxial analgesia or intercostal nerve blocks, and careful use of opioids should be implemented. Non-opioid analgesics such as non-steroidal are also an integral part of the multimodal analgesia treatment. This is a simple figure showing what exactly leads to myasthenia gravis. If there is an ongoing myasthenic gravis crisis, you have to, on the left side, pyridostigmine, it prevents crisis exacerbation. What the patients have to follow is, the patients have to be early to rise, patients have to start their activities early in the day, tensilone given in case of crisis, you should take adequate rest, periods of rest in between, you have to avoid infection, stress and exercises, and if there is an active crisis going on, you have to move ahead with plasmapheresis, that is removing the attacking antibodies, replace the IgG antibodies, and adrafonium or tensilone can be given. Always watch for the airway and secretions. Now, we'll move to myasthenic crisis and cholinergic crisis. Myasthenic crisis, the onset of postoperative myasthenic crisis with the associated respiratory insufficiency requiring mechanical ventilation can occur at any time. Overall, the reported incidence of postoperative myasthenia crisis ranges from 11.5% to 18.2%. In awake patients, signs of impending crisis can include dysphagia, change in phonation, obstruction, weak cough, and difficulty in handling secretion. Since the myasthenia gravis patients has a normal respiratory drive, the first sign of impending crisis can be an increase in respiratory rate or shallower tidal volume pits. Use of accessory muscles or paradoxical movement of the abdomen may be seen even in patients who are still intubated at the end of surgery. Blood gas may be gases may initially show hypocapnia in spontaneously breathing patients. Given that patients with myasthenia crisis have high mortality rates, approximately 4.47%, it is imperative to identify its triggers such as infection, residual anesthetics, and withholding or tapering of myasthenia gravis medications. Stress of surgery alone may be sufficient to precipitate a myasthenia crisis. Kanai et al. Conducted a study to determine and validate clinical prediction scores for postoperative myasthenia crisis using a multicenter database in Japan. They assigned point values as follows: 3 points for vital capacity less than 80%, 2 points for disease duration less than 3 months, and 1 point for bulbar symptoms immediately before thymectomy. Out of the potential total of 6 points, a score of at least 3 points predicted postoperative myasthenia crisis with a sensitivity of 88.2% and specificity of 83.3%. If weakness at the end of surgery is suggestive of myasthenia crisis, then the patient should be maintained on mechanical ventilation and transferred to an intensive care unit. Treatment of myasthenia crisis should be coordinated with a neurologist. In addition to immunomodulation, urgent therapy with plasma exchange or intravenous immunoglobulin is often initiated. The use of plasma exchange during myasthenia crisis has been associated with earlier extubation. In addition, male gender, advanced age greater than 50 years, atelectasis, and ventilator-associated pneumonia significantly contributed to prolonged mechanical ventilation. Postoperative cholinergic crisis refers to paradoxical muscular weakness along with other signs of cholinergic stimulation such as nausea, emesis, diarrhea, abdominal pain, lacrimation, diaphoresis, blurred vision, meiosis, and sialorrhea. Outside the operating room, the incidence of cholinergic crisis is low, but it may occur in myasthenia gravis patients preoperatively or postoperatively after the administration of an anticholinesterase. In such cases, prolonged paralysis often results. The treatment of cholinergic crisis consists of supportive therapy, atropine 0.4 to 2 mg intravenously or glycopyrrolate 0.2 to 1 mg intravenously to counteract the muscarinic effects and respiratory support until the muscle strength improves. To conclude, surgical thymectomy continues to be indicated for many myasthenia gravis patients with or without thymomatous disease. When possible, minimal invasive techniques for thymectomy should be considered as they have been associated with lower morbidity and enhanced recovery in this at-risk patient population. The perioperative care of patients scheduled to undergo thymectomy for myasthenia gravis should be focused on medical optimization, the uninterrupted administration of immunomodulatory and anticholinesterase medications, along with minimization of factors which can trigger myasthenia or cholinergic crisis. While the use of neuromuscular blocking agents is best avoided, their judicious titration should be guided by quantitative neuromuscular monitoring and reversal achieved with Sugammadex rather than neostigmine. A multimodal postoperative analgesia approach should include regional anesthesia techniques in combination with non-opioid analgesia. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Hari Krishnan, for that clear-cut presentation on myasthenia gravis. What was done was in the last 22 minutes, Hari Krishnan covered the prevalence, characteristics of myasthenia gravis, pathophysiology, how to do the atrophonium test, what are the preoperative investigation in which he mentioned about ECG, echocardiography, PFT, CT, thyroid function tests. And then he went on to surgical management and then anesthetic management. He mentioned that chloroquines and aminoglycosides must be avoided. GA with mechanical ventilation, one lung ventilation was mentioned, with or without epidural. Some cases have been done with LMA. And then he mentioned the role of neuromuscular blockers. And then he mostly dealt with myasthenic and cholinergic crisis. And the talk is open for discussion. Anybody wants to comment or question ask questions. Please unmute yourself and speak up on the microphone, please.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir. Nice presentation by Dr. Hari Krishna. He covered almost the entire this one. My this one is, as an anesthesiologist, cardiac anesthesiologist, other than cardiac surgery, the most common surgery is the thymectomy, sir. I have done cases as a sole eye thoracic epidural, as a sole anesthetic, and none of the patient had any problems, sir. How do this one? Because especially this cannot be done in type 4 and 5 type of classification, but initial type 1, type 2, type 3 can be done as a main source of main soul of this one, anesthetic management.
No, that's a very good technique. I used high thoracic epidural because you do not use any relaxants and probably you can get away without giving GA. If you have the patient well prepared mentally, and that's a reasonably good technique. I like that, actually.
Other drug interaction is, sir, the antiarrhythmics. They are more prone for drug interactions.
Yes.
That antiarrhythmics, especially the cordron and all, enhances the this one.
Yes.
Myasthenic crisis more.
Yes, I agree. Regarding the use of anticholinesterases before surgery, if the patient is already getting pyridostigmine,
yes, sir.
What I usually do is, if the patient is having mild to moderate disease, I don't give it in the morning.
Yes, sir.
But if the patient is having severe disease, it's better to give, because the patient may feel a bit uncomfortable while waiting for the surgery in the morning.
Yes.
But if the patient is mild disease or moderate disease, we can skip the morning dose. That will help us in probably intubating the patient without the use of skeletal muscle relaxants. Because we know that isoflurane by itself and most of the inhalational agents by themselves do have a bit of neuromuscular blocking action, and they always enhance the neuromuscular blockade caused by other agents, non-depolarizing agents. And the other thing is choice of muscle relaxant. I would go for sesarfatrium or atracurium.
Atracurium, minimal dose of titratable dose of atracurium should be suffice.
I will go for that because I know that it will be, the body will get rid of that without any issue. So the recovery may be a little better with atracurium or sesarfatrium. Dr. Ratan Gupta is available. Would you like to come in? Ratan Gupta, Anup?
Yeah. Good evening.
Good evening. Come. Yes.
Yeah. I think it was a very nice presentation. We spoke particularly about thymectomy. The other thing what we see in the ICU is this patient's coming for cardiac surgery, especially CABG. Sometimes it might be a diagnosed case, and we struggle with the weaning of these patients because of concomitant medicines, and they have their own muscle weakness persisting. So we may have to strategize how to wean them. And the other thing is, in case you'll end up into trouble and you're not able to wean off these patients, sometimes you may have to use ferresis and immunoglobulin therapy in the post-operative, so that you can wean off these patients. And in case you have to use both, I think first you should always plan for ferresis, and later as a last choice, you should keep immunoglobulin therapy, because in case you do immunoglobulin therapy and then later you have to do ferresis, you will actually be removing the immunoglobulins. Yes. So that you should keep it in mind. Yeah.
Dr. Anup, do you want to say something? Dr. Anup Varghese.
Yes, sir. So, Hare Krishna has made a very good presentation. He has covered almost all aspects about the myasthenia gravis and the pathophysiology as well, very nicely explained. And also the parts about the anesthetic management and especially the respiratory involvement that is associated with that one. So when we're coming to the critical care part of it, the possibility of a prolonged ventilation or delayed extubations and all have to be explained to the relatives. When the patient is coming in for thymoma surgery, that is definitely one thing that we have to keep in mind. Another thing which we have to keep in mind with many of these patients, especially with the grade 1 and grade 2 disease, they may be coming not just for thymoma surgery, they might be coming for a cardiac surgery, where we may have to use a CPB machine as well. So when we are using hypothermia during CPB, the hypothermia per se in these patients can lead to a reduction in the muscle strength. And so that can lead to a delayed awakening later on in the postoperative period. So in such patients, we have to be careful about why the patient is having weakness in the period. We have to go in coordination with the multi-specialty consultation. Sometimes in the severe cases and all, we may have to consider plasmapheresis also for these patients, so that to remove all the excess load of antibodies from the body, from the system, before we can progress these patients.
Yes, yes. Yes, I
do. And also, when you're using neuromuscular blockers for these patients, especially in the current scenario, we can use rocuronium instead of using the atracurium or cesarean. They're also very good choices. But when we're having rocuronium, especially when Sugammatex is also available, that is a very good option if the patients do not recover in the post-operative period.
Yes, yes. Oh, no, meeting only the Nimishabha. That is correct. That's correct. Only thing is, usually in myasthenia gravis, usually the discussion also includes what is myasthenic syndrome, Eaton-Lambert syndrome, and how this differs from myasthenia gravis. Hare Krishna, would you like to say something on this? Because usually that completes the whole discussion. In the exam, invariably, they will ask, what is myasthenic syndrome?
Sir, the major difference between myasthenic syndrome and Lambert-Eaton syndrome is the antibodies are actually directed against calcium channels in Lambert-Eaton syndrome, sir. So it is okay. Lambert-Eaton syndrome is more of a presynaptic involvement, sir. The calcium, right. It prevents right. The influx of calcium into the presynaptic terminal, as a result of which if the calcium is not getting influxed there, acetylcholine release from the presynaptic terminal is getting interrupted. And so acetylcholine doesn't enter into the neuromuscular junctions.
Yes. And Eaton-Lambert syndrome is usually associated with Oat cell carcinoma of the lung. That's another point. And it is male predominant, and the age group is higher than 40 to 50 years. It's a disease of the middle and the elderly age group. So these are some of the differentiating points. And there's some drug called 4-aminopyridine that is supposed to be good in those patients. That's what.
Sir, I want to add.
Yes.
Sir, Kedar here, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, in Eaton-Lambert syndrome, the activity improves. In myasthenia, if you continue some activity, the quality of the activity is degraded. And on the contrary, on the Eaton-Lambert syndrome, if you continue some activity, the quality improves. That is a difference.
Right. Thank you for that point. So usually this sir. Is asked in the exam. That's why I brought up this. Otherwise, I would not have said. Any other comments or questions? Let me see the chat box. I don't see any question here. We have to remember the risk factors for post-operative ventilation, which includes vital capacity less than 2 liters. 2 liters, and duration of myasthenia more than 6 years, and the pyridostigmine dose is more than 750 milligram per day, and
history recent onset of disease. Yes, recent or yes. Onset of pulmonary disease.
Yes. Preoperative bulbar symptoms, yes. Also indicate postoperative ventilation. Anybody else wants to say something?
Sir, any patient in cardiac surgery? Hello.
Yes.
So if the a difficult weaning from the ventilation, you have to think of this condition also, sir. Because I've seen so many patients 2-3 days without any movements, without after giving neostigmine, patients started breathing well and extubated. Some of the patients.
Yes. See, we have to exclude neuromuscular blockade at the end of post-operative ventilation before we extubate the patients.
Mm.
So there may be residual neuromuscular blockade. That's the commonest cause for what we call as residual curarization. So my tendency is to use lesser pancuronium in the theater.
Yes.
Go for medium acting or short acting drugs so that problem does not arise. I also know what you said is correct. Sometimes patients are not responding till the next day, and you start wondering what is gone wrong with the patient. Then the patient recovers without any much problem. And actual reason is this neuromuscular blockers, especially pancuronium, sticks to the neuromuscular junction for a long time. And especially if the patient is hypothermic and renal function is not optimal, hepatic metabolism is not optimal, the action of these drugs will be prolonged. It may not be exactly myasthenic syndrome, but it is neuromuscular blockade because of residual neuromuscular paralysis.
Sir, we have come across similar cases in post-operative, especially the patients undergoing rheumatic heart disease-related surgeries who have severe cardiac cachexia. We have seen patients, they have good train of four response, but they are just immobile and they can't move. They don't even respond. And it might take sometimes 24 hours or more for these patients to become awake. Maybe it's a combination of a lot of other factors like hypothermia
nutrition, and
especially the patients with the rheumatic heart disease. Elderly patients, they take a long time.
Yes. I agree. I think I don't see any more questions in the chat box. Thank you, Dr. Hari Krishnan, for that presentation. Thank you, Dr. Prabhu Shankar, Dr. Gupta, Dr. Anup, for your contributions. We'll meet on Sunday with a TE topic at 9 a.m. and Monday at 7 p.m. with a critical care cardiac anesthesia topic. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Hari Krishna. Thank you, faculties, and thank you, attendees. And we'll meet on Sunday for TE session and on Monday for FCA classes. We'll updated schedule would be sent via respective WhatsApp groups. Kindly check for the same for iterative schedules. Thank you all. Thank you very much.